Ladies and gentlemen, kindly take your seats. We would appreciate it very much if you could kindly turn your electronic devices to silent mode. Thank you. Tun Dr. Siti Hasmah binti Muhammad Ali.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Selamat pagi. Very good morning. Yang berbahagia, Tun Dr. Siti Hasmah binti Muhammad Ali, our honorable guest and speaker this morning. Yang berbahagia, Dato' Muhammad Nazir, Muhammad Noor, representing the Board of Governors of Perdana University. Yang teramat mulia, Tunku Profesor Dato' Dr. Sofia Jiwa, founder of the Yayasan Tun Sufian, and bahagia Tan Sri Dato' Dr. Abdul Aziz Abdul Rahman, Chair of the Tun Sufian Foundation. Yang berbahagia Professor Dato' Dr. Andrew Mohanraj, the author of the book Battling Adversity that will be launched today. Yang berbahagia Tuan Puan Aisyah Ong, members of the Board of Governors of Perdana University, members of the Board of Trustees of Tun Sufian Foundation, deans, professors, students, Tansi Dato, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Ahmad bin Hussein. I'm the Vice Chancellor of Perdana University. It is with great pleasure that I welcome all of you to this lecture on primary healthcare to be delivered by Yang Mabahagia Tun Dr. Siti Hasmah binti Muhammad Ali in conjunction with the launching of Perdana University's Tun Dr. Siti Hasmah lecture series on public health, as well as the launching of a book on mental health authored by Professor Dato' Andrew Mohanraj and published by Yayasan Tun Sufian. Yang Mabahagia Tun, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, before we begin, may I request that we observe a moment of silence as we remember our loved ones that have left us, and as we seek the blessings of the Almighty, and as we supplicate for His mercy, for His guidance, and for His compassion. Al-Fatiha. kami. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, today's event is the first in a series of public engagements by Perdana University planned for 2016. And indeed, 2016 will be a historic year for the university as it enters its fifth year of formal existence and as it opens itself for a series of accreditation and recognition exercises for the courses that it offers by external agencies like the Malaysian Qualifications Agency, the Malaysian Medical Council, the Irish Medical Council, and the World Federation of Occupational Therapists. 2016, too, will be the year that Perdana will have its first convocation for its first group of graduates. And we are most honored to welcome such an important year for the institutional memory of this medical and health science-oriented university with a lecture on public health, on primary health care, by none other than Yama Bhagyatun, and the launching of a public lecture series in her good name. Thank you, ma'am, for permitting us to render your good name to our public lecture series. The Tun Dr. Hasmah lecture series on public health aims to honor, to appreciate, and to celebrate the tireless efforts by Yama Bhagyatun Dr. Siti Hasmah in championing various aspects of public health, particularly in the role and contribution of women in health in rural areas, in maternal and child health, in family medicine, and in pregnancy and childbearing. The lecture series will invite renowned speakers from time to time to deliver public lectures, especially in these areas of public health. Ladies and gentlemen, before I call upon Yama Bhagyatun to deliver her talk and to launch the lecture series, please allow me the honor to introduce her. Of course, I can take the whole morning to talk about the contribution and achievements of Yama Bhagyatun in the decades that she has been serving the community in her various capacities. But let me touch on a few areas most relevant to our topic today. On a personal note, of course, we all know that Yama Bhagyatun is the partner in marriage to the fourth Prime Minister of Malaysia, Tun Dr. Mahathir Mohamad, who served as Prime Minister from 1981 to 2003. And currently, Dr. Siti Hasmah is the Chancellor of the Multimedia University. Tun Dr. Siti Hasmah is among the first Malay woman doctors in Malaysia, and the first woman to be appointed a medical officer in government service for the state of Kedah. And through her service, she has set an example of personal and professional achievement for all women in Malaysia. And since the appointment of her husband as Prime Minister in 1981, she has used her position as the wife of the Prime Minister to campaign tirelessly for women's health, for family planning, for drug abuse control, and for adult literacy. She has served in various positions that range from presidency of the Malaysian Girl Guides Association and chairman of the Kedah Family Planning Association, president of the Malaysian Medical Association Foundation, president of Association for the Rehabilitation of Handicapped Children, through to being vice president of the Federation of Family Planning Association in Malaysia, patron of the Malaysian Association of Maternal Health, patron of the Malaysian Pediatric Association, and patron of the Badminton Association of Malaysia. Tun Dr. Siti Hasmah has also been very active internationally in promoting the cause of rural women. In 1992, she was chosen as one of the six core group initiators of First Ladies representing the Asia-Pacific region at the Summit for the Economic Advancement of Rural Women in Geneva. And in September 1995, she was appointed as chairperson of Regional Steering Committee on the Economic Advancement of Rural and Island Women for Asia-Pacific region, and eventually she took over the presidency of the International Steering Committee. And being a medical doctor by training, Dr. Siti Hasmah also has an interest in mental health. and former First Lady of the United States, Rosalynn Carter, invited Dr. Siti Hasmah to serve on the National Committee for the World Federation of Mental Health, which Mrs. Carter chaired. And how fitting it is that she's here today with us this morning to also launch a book that brings together a collection of essays on society and mental health. Ladies and gentlemen, for the 23 years of public service, her voluntary work, and her leadership in the fields of public health and literacy and drug abuse control, Tun has received many, many honors. The Yang di Pertuan Agong, as well as the Sultan of Selangor and Sultan of Kedah, has bestowed titles upon her. And other awards include the Country McLaren Award by the Asia Pacific Consortium for Public Health, honorary doctorates from University of Bangsaan, from Royal College of Physicians of Ireland, from Indiana University Bloomington, and from the University of Victoria, British Columbia, Canada. In 2003, she was conferred the highest honorary title of Tun, along with her husband Dr. Mahathir, by the Yang di Pertuan Agong of Malaysia. And Dr. Siti Hasmah still retains a professional interest in maternal and child health in rural areas, in the disabled people and their welfare. She continues to have an interest learning how other countries tackle their rural health problems and traditional practices. She's still active in anti-smoking and anti-narcotics campaign, and she's still active in other interests, especially in handicrafts and listening to good classical music. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, Yang Amat Bahagia Tun Dr. Siti Hasmah will deliver a talk this morning on primary health care, a topic that is very, very close indeed to her heart. She will share with us the story of her journey through a rich experience of public service and leadership in the world of healthcare. A story that must be told, a story that must be heard, and a story that must be recorded. Without further ado, ladies and gentlemen, please join me to invite Yang Amat Bahagia to Dr. Siti Hasmah to deliver her talk.
Thank you, Dr. Zain. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. In the name of the Almighty, the Most Merciful, the Most Gracious, and the Most Compassionate. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May the blessings of Allah be upon us all. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, Yang Berbahagia, Tuan Syed Ahmad Hussein, Vice Chancellor of Perdana University, Tan Sri, and Deans of Faculties, Professors and Students, members of the Board of Governors, Perdana University, and members of Tun Sufian's support for this foundation, the students, ladies and gentlemen. First of all, thank you, Dr. Syed, for being so kind to me. I'm really very, very embarrassed for that you said everything about me, but now I'm a little bit nervous because my audience is of different levels of intelligence, and so I have to be very careful of what I say, and also I hope it will be of benefit to not only all of us here, but to the younger generations, which I'm really targeting my short talk. But at first, I'd like to express my gratitude to Allah because of getting us here in an environment of peace and goodwill and harmony, And also I would like to thank Putana University for giving me this privilege and honor of launching its first series of public health lectures, and also giving me the privilege of giving a short talk about my experience as a doctor. Ladies and gentlemen, it's sometimes boring for the young ones to listen to what has been done in the past. But we have to remind them off and on that without knowing what happened in the past, they would not appreciate what they are doing now, and also they can improve on it and for the future. So bear with me, young students. I was always called the lady of two eras, because I did my service before independence, and starting 1955, and also after independence. So I know both environments during the British era and also after our independence. Now, I graduated in 1955, and we went into the King Edward VII College of Medicine in 1947 as the second batch of medical students when the colleges, King Edward VII College of Medicine and Raffles College for Arts, reopened after the war. And I wasn't actually in the beginning keen to be a medical doctor. I was aiming to be a journalist. And thinking that I should have taken that job. It's more lucrative. Huh? But when I went to the selection board, they interviewed me and then asked me why I want to become a journalist. I said I like to read and write, and also I had one A in English, so I was happy to be in Raffles College. And they asked me, did you apply for a second place in other institutions? I said, yes. I applied to be in the College of Medicine. I said, okay, what are your qualifications? I said, I have only one A. I have A in English, a C in Maths, and a C in Biology. That was all that I had. And I had the audacity to have to apply to go into the College of Medicine, King Edward VII College of Medicine. And then after a while, they look at each other and they look at the papers. I said, okay, you don't have to go to the other interviews, and just wait for our reply. I said, okay, thank you. And I went on thinking that I will not get a place in the colleges in Singapore because of my qualification. But I think they had considered me to go into the College of Medicine because I was the only Malay girl who applied for it. I was brave enough to apply for it, and I got it. So I was blessed, and until now I thought that I've been blessed to, excuse me, it won't make me nervous. I was blessed to be born a girl, and I was blessed to be born to Malay parents, a Muslim of course, and I was happy that I was blessed to choose medicine after the interview, to do medicine instead of journalism. And this switch came about when, during the Japanese occupation, my mother was, I think she had now, thinking backwards, she had very, very severe either dysentery or cholera at the time. And she was so, so bad, so much so that my father gathered all of his 10 children around him and near my mother, who was crouched all the time at the bathroom, and to say prayers for her. We thought we would have lost her then during the Japanese occupation, because that time medicine was so poor and facilities were not available. But fortunately, by grace of Allah, she recovered, and both of them encouraged me and to do medicine. I caught it, and I said yes. I was not afraid of blood. I was not afraid of looking at lacerations and all that. And so I said, okay, I go to do medicine in Singapore. And they allowed me. At that time, no Malaygal would have been allowed to go as far as outside the village or outside the house compound. My father was a government servant, and he had no money to send me to university. But fortunately, I had what we call at that time financial aid. Now you have scholarship that days and so forth, and loans. But at that time there was nothing, ladies and gentlemen, except for financial aids, which means that they give you all the courses will be free, accommodation free, books for free, but only the monthly allowance will be given to you, and that's called financial aid. And when I entered, my mother sent me to Singapore, and I still remember when I go to Singapore and see the columns of the King Edward VII College of Medicine, where I stood with my mother, and I bid goodbye to me. She warned me. She said, not warned me, she advised me. She said, do well and take care of yourself. And then she left. Then she went off, and I was alone, going into the hall to register myself. And there were lots of people, of course, the new students. We were 1947 batch, the second batch after the war. And the opportunities then were very, very small. Not everybody can go, but still, there were students, mostly Chinese, Indian, very few Malays. There were seven Malay boys and a girl, and there was a girl. It sounds like, you know, Snow White and seven. I was alone, I don't know what to do. But I'm a person who was easy in getting friends from everyone, multiracial. Because I was brought up like that in school. Standard 1, St. Mary's, I was the only girl. The others were Chinese and Indians. Then I found myself in standard 3, I jumped into standard 3, and found another Malay girl there, and there was my sister. So that's what happened during the British era. Yeah. And so I took 8 years with no health science except for biology. I was very, very poor in physics and chemistry. I didn't understand why a straight line can go somewhere else and so forth. And that time, a friend of mine from Kedah just didn't believe me that this language girl is so bodo that she needs to be tutored for them. So I graduated after 8 years. The first year I failed badly with three other Malay girls out of the seven, Malay boys out of the seven. Failed very badly, and they had to leave. But I was fortunate, as I said, we are Malay girl, and I think the British at that particular time also wanted to have this affirmative action system, knowing that this Malay girl is a Bumiputra or a native of Malaya, had to give her a chance to do it again. So I repeated my first year tension, and then went on climbing each step every year, climbing 2 steps, and then dropping one, take 3 subjects, drop one to one every month. I'm known as the student who takes examinations every 6 months. And I think that gives me also an experience how to be patient and how to be very diligent. Yeah? And especially when my father said, Hasmah, said, you try to do your medicine and do well. And later on, when he says that, when he saw that I was close with somebody, and he said, Hasmah, I said, finish your study first before you think of marriage. Okay, so my father has said something. Okay, so I graduated in 1955, And the first thing I did, first place I was posted in the bus, Selangor. I'm a Selangor person. And that was where I did my internship in a general hospital Kuala Lumpur. You will never know. I don't think all of you were born then, but I must tell you that and those who are at my age would know, would picture how General Hospital Kuala Lumpur was in 1955, before independence. It was just long, long buildings and with big doors which opens and closes, and we have to close it every evening to prevent the cats and the dogs coming in. So I was in charge of the pediatric ward, and 36 beds. One side 18, and the other side also 18. One side's full of diphtheria cases of children coming with diphtheria, and already the next the tracheotomy tubes already in. And the other side is full of children with tuberculosis, meningitis, stiff. And these are all toddlers, and it breaks the heart. I was almost about to be a pediatrician when I saw them. And these diphtheria cases come in the night, and the hospital assistant in the casualty room were already so expert that when the mother comes with the baby who's already blue because the throat had been covered by the membrane, then they know exactly what to do. They just wrap the child in the towel or in the sheet of cloth, put the child, hold the child across the stretcher, across the couch, and then the head hanging down, almost touching my lap, and I will be facing the boy with one hand feeling where the trachea is, and with one hand a scaffold. And you'll never know this. I hate to do it, but I had to do it because it's a matter of life and death. Just with the scaffold, stab. Now, other people are doing it for different reasons, but I'm saving a life. You know, stab and twist. And there was the whole dressing open, an outlet for the child to splutter out all the dirty membranes and breathe again. You can imagine the face of the mother. She was crying when she came in, pleading face to please help the child. And then after the tracheotomy, when we're done putting the tracheotomy tube, tying it up on the neck of the child, and the child was breathing calmly, and you could see the blue face turning pink. You have saved a life. And you could see the mother's face, still tearing, but with a smile, as if to say, thank you. So that's the reward that you get, ladies and gentlemen, young students. That's the reward you get. Don't think of monetary reward. Your reward will come much, much later. When you want to become a doctor, you must have the attitude that you work, you do service for money. Don't think of that. God, you want your experience. You must have experience from the place where you work and the people you meet and everyone else who is very thankful to you when you do something good for them. And so, the next morning I will go back to my ward and clean all the baby's throats, the tracheal tubes, the splutter and everything. We give them injection, of course, penicillin at that time. And the mother will be there holding the head while I clean the trachees, all 18 of them in a row until they are discharged. At the other side, with the tuberculosis meningitis, the children, the adults get it in their lungs, but the children will have meningitis. And they come in stiff, and we had to do this painful thing for them, spinal function, to put in the streptomycin through the spinal column. And that's painful for them. Every morning I have to do that for them. But what to do, that was the only treatment that. But they survived, toddlers. And at that time, ladies and gentlemen, the infant mortality rate before independent, 75,000 live births. So that was, and you know, I noticed that in 1955, that the patients that came especially the children that came to hospital for treatment, were all Chinese patients, Chinese children. Why? Because they are the ones who stayed the current stay around Kuala Lumpur, and the sanitation was bad, dense, and the housing was bad, housing sanitation was bad, and too crowded. So they are the ones who get this communicable diseases very, very fast. And they come. What about the Malays? Well, the Malays were nowhere from India, it's still in rural areas there, and that they were not keen to come to hospital. Probably the child must have died in their homes. So that's the difference I noticed. And also during the British era, ladies and gentlemen, the 13 states have all general hospitals. And depending what the level of the state were, straight settlement, of course, we have the highest equipment and doctors and so forth. And then the federated Malay states, the four, Perak, Pahang, Selangor, and Sembilan, will have good hospitals, also general hospitals. And non-federated Malay states will have general hospitals, but skeletal stuff. That is the level of the difference in the equipment and staffing of the general hospitals. Other places, well, there are district hospitals, and manned by one doctor. And other than that, far away places, there's no such thing as Pusat Kesihatan health clinics in the rural areas at that time, no. But there were government dispensaries out, far out, manned by hospital assistants who can do anything. He can stitch up wounds, they can give injections, and in one or two cases, they even do appendectomy. And he was so trained, because he was working alone, and he was given all the opportunities to do what doctors do. So that was the situation then. And the diseases that were rampant then, 1955, in the 1950s, malaria. Cerebral malaria, falciparum, were the worst of the malaria diseases, and of course, the mortality is high. Especially when Belda schemes were first opened, the workers that go in to cut the forest at that time, they were the ones who suffered from cerebral malaria. Now you don't see. You don't see them. And then the second one is, of course, tuberculosis. The adults kept them in the lungs and the children kept them in the brain. Yes, and there were not very much of medication. For tuberculosis, it was just streptomycin and rest. So that's why they have centurions, but their centurions at that time only for the Europeans. Okay? For us, they go to, for the British here, they go to Sumatra for rest in the sanatorium for TB. And in Langkawi, there was a sanatorium for TB patients also. Yeah? So that was a situation. It was very bad. The rural people were neglected. And after, I was very happy then that I did manage to go around for that 1 year housemanship. Just 1 year then, we worked 24 hours, ladies and gentlemen, 24 hours as a housemanship, and our pay was just 400 ringgit. And after 3 months, we had a rise in salary, 401 ringgit. And because then they want us to be eligible for EPF, so you have to be 400 plus. So 401 ringgit. You are lucky nowadays. So we learned a lot, and I learned a lot there. Thinking about those people who were in the urban areas who suffered the rampant diseases that were rampant, of course, as I said, malaria, tuberculosis, cardiac, heart attacks, and so forth. There was no medicine for heart attacks. There was no ECG, no ultrasounds and so forth. So we just give them morphia for the pain and digitalis to suggest. And they go home with advice to please rest and so forth. But these are a lot from the Indian communities and from the Malay communities. Right? But they come later will have another heart attack and doesn't pass on. So they were dead. I didn't know anything about the maternal and child then because it was in another hospital. I was stuck with the hospital only. Then, 1956, I was transferred to Kedah, very rural. Any Kedah hunter, I'm sorry, but the time is Kedah is very rural, undeveloped, but a lot of doctors wanted to go there. But when they go there, they see the hospital, they go on a quiet. Incognito told me that that was what I noticed. They go to the posting in Kedah, before their posting, they go around the town, and then they go back. And they never reported to us. Because Alusta was really a quiet town, rural, and there not much of activities there. But I was posted there. I'm glad. Some people say that even my relatives say that Hasmah will not survive in Alusta, even with my husband. But I survived. I took the risk, I took the challenge of going there as a woman doctor. I was the second. There was another woman, Malay woman doctor, in the hospital. That's Dr. Salman Smile. And she was the first one to graduate from King Edward the VII College of Medicine. So she was in the hospital wards. I was in charge of the outpatient. And there I could see the type of diseases and the income of the people who were so different from what I saw in GH Kuala Lumpur. They were finding a Malay woman doctor gives me a lot of problem also because I consider myself an expatriate from Selangor. This is born, city born. And the first thing I have to do is to learn the language. Kedah language is very different. It's not language, it's a dialect. And I keep on asking, what do they say? What do they say? And then my nurse will interpret for me. They didn't understand what I was saying, and I didn't understand what they were saying. I said, why can't the husband follow her to Senakichi? Senakichi, if there's so much difficulty for her to go there. And the nurse would smile at me and say, doctor, so like she means she wants to pass urine, she wants to pee. So it's possible for the Samatua, husband support Samatua, she won. Samatua Tabri could have been. So these are the things which you will have to go through. Yeah? It is an experience, a very interesting experience. So when I was there, I was put in outpatients, okay, I found the diseases much, much different. And then, of course, malaria and tuberculosis were there, rampant. And the next one was diarrhea, gastroenteritis for children, and the waterborne diseases, fever, and adults have lots of other things, such as dengue, because they were not taking their food properly after postnatal period. Now, what was very, very disturbing then was the aggressiveness of the diseases, tuberculosis, polio, diphtheria, tetanus, whooping cough. These are the killers of children at that time. Why? Because at that time, the vaccination or immunization program were not pushed forward aggressively enough. They just gave an injection penicillin for whatever they cover and that was all. But even from then, if a child comes to the hospital with a sore throat or with fever, the first thing the doctor will do is open the mouth and see what is inside. But now I believe not very many doctors are doing it and they have missed the diphtheritic membrane, which can kill the child. So that was one. And then maternal and child health, there was no, because there was none, because the MCH facilities were far and beyond. We who worked in the hospital, we had to go to Yen or to Padang Terap or to Pendang bi-weekly or every 2 weeks to attend to antenatal mothers. And I used to go with my car to those to these places because they didn't have a proper MCH clinic then. Yeah. And I remember every time when I go to Kuala Nerang, which is really far from Alustra with my car and an attendant, and we have to report to the police station first because that was still a red district for the communists. We haven't gone, we have not been freed from the communists yet, so we have to go to the police station and then only to the clinic to report ourselves. And every time you at the police station, tell me, I said, doctor, jangan lambat-lambat, don't be too late to go back. I said, why? You'll meet a dato on the road. That was that time. But I believe recently a female dato was had a car accident, a tanker, at the KL truck road. There was a time when tankers were still roaming around, and we had to be very careful. So that was the time. And it is very sad when you go to the hospital and working there, you'll be very, you know, sometimes you get hot-tempered and frustrated yourself. Because as generally 80% of the population in Kedah are in rural. And they never want to come to the hospital. Why? Because they fear. Fear of what? We never could understand why until you go into the public health section, into the rural areas to work. That was how I understood why rural people didn't want to come to hospital. They fear, not only fear, but other factors as well. Fortunately, when I was transferred to Kedah, Tun Abdul Razak, our second prime minister, he was the one who pushed the 5-year development program into the country. He was a great man, and I always admire him because he comes to the grassroots level to look at what he pushed to do for the rural people. The 5-year rural development program deals with the 4 evils of rural areas, and that is poverty, ill health, illiteracy, and apathy. These 4 evils which you find in rural areas at that time, to remind them. And he tackled them one by one with his red book, like Mao Zedong's red book, which was a big, big one. We keep them in the office, district office, and we have a meeting every month with the district officer. And I was pleased because I was only Malay girl. I was in a risk. I have challenges. I don't know how they would treat me as the only Malay woman, but they respect me for my profession. They need me and I need them too. So we coordinated and we became very, we have a good relationship with them. Now, ladies and gentlemen, for you to work in the rural areas, we have to do certain things which will make you a success with your clients in the rural areas. Don't think of money, as I mentioned just now. They will come with fruits, durian, and kutung, bananas, kadang-kadang too, with a bag full of rice to show their appreciation. It's not a bribery, it's just a donation. No, it's not a donation. It's just appreciation of what they feel for you, you know, so accept it. And to be working in the rural areas, ladies, especially ladies, you have to be dressed properly. At that time, I used to fight with the Ministry of Health, the Principal Matron, the Director General, because I want our nurses to change their costume, their uniform. They are now in that costume, uniforms which I bought for them, pants and jackets. Formerly they were in skirts. So you can imagine a midwife having to cross her legs to attend to a delivery. It was terrible. Yet she had to bring extra sarung to cover her knees and so forth. So we fought for them to change the uniform to blouse and pants. and they have done so now, and with their heads covered, I don't mind. I have sometimes objections to people wearing a headscarf, but for the medical health profession, they need it. They look very nice. So that was done, and then what happened was, you have to, after graduation, you must stick to your attitude towards being a doctor. We find nowadays that after graduation, our young people, they change their profession. I don't know why, maybe because of frustration, unemployment, but there's something push them out of being a medical person and into some other things. Now, I would advise you not to do that, because for one thing, the scholarship of parent scholarship has been spent on your being a doctor. Keep to it. It's a noble profession. You are doing service to the people, and the people will reward you, and even God will bless you with what service you have done for the people. But they need you, not only in urban areas, but now in the suburban areas. And the diseases that you find will be changing all the time, and you have to be very, very alert to find out what you can do for them. Now, during the time, as I said, I was in Halustar. I concentrated more on maternal and child health, but the maternity ward. And there, working in the hospital then, and I was 8 years in hospital before I left and went to the rural district. And I found many things. In the hospital, we had to be very careful. Instead of shouting at the patients, why do you come late? Why do you do this? Why do you do that? Why did you come earlier? You have to understand why. You know? And then when I was in hospital for 8 years, I was acting medical superintendent the last 2 years, because the hospital, Alos Hospital, will be upgraded into a houseman training hospital. So we upgraded the hospital, have more beds and so forth. But towards the end of my term in the hospital as an acting medical superintendent, we had cholera epidemic. And this is something which I want to tell you about, how you can get a win-win situation when you deal with people, especially rural people, who are stubborn and don't see your point of view and the good health, for example. Cholera epidemic came after 6 months after Malacca had it. So Malacca had a cholera epidemic first, and Dr. Rajanuddin, I'm sure you remember who he was, the famous doctor for Jamban Jitra. He founded the Jamban Jitra, and he was director general then. He was a good friend of mine. We graduated the same school in Singapore, and he came up. And he appointed me to sit in the committee for the hospital, which was still acting superintendent, and also for the health side. So I was in both sides. We bring in the patients who are moribund on a stretcher, almost dead, bring in, and I have to reserve three wards, male, female, and contacts. So it's all three of them, and we admit them, and the first thing we do is to hydrate them, put them on a drip, and then give them some antibiotic, and just wait for the diarrhea to stop. And that time, patients come in, the nurses have to do the rubber rats. Remember the red rubber rats, the rubber sheets that we put on the beds of our patients? We have to cut a big hole in the center for that to be put on the bed so that the fecal matter drops into a bin underneath the bed. So that was one. And then, public health inspectors have to go around the area. It is all occurring in the riverine areas of Alustar and other districts getting here and so forth. So it was a drought season, of course. They had no water. So they go to the river. The wells were dry, and the river water is still flowing at that time. But unfortunately, those quite in the north, in the Ulu of the rivers, they were having their latrines on the Asian river. They used that as a latrine where they defecate into the river itself, and down the stream, the other villagers were using that same water for domestic purposes. So you can imagine, you can actually see when the next station, where the next station will come. Because this is all from the river water. So our committee was very aggressive. Dr. Reginald Dean came and advised us what to do. We burned all the latrines on the riverine, by the riverside, and the public health overseers, the junior public health inspectors, go in and produce this jamban jitra bowls to help the kampung folks to do their sanitary bowls for their own latrines, not on the riverside, but on land, on the kampungs, in the compound, but far away from the wells. They dig wells and they do the bowls for them. And that helped. And the public health inspector will go around each district, each mukim, each village, to seek out all these tech under cholera patients. The cholera patients must come in, that's definite. But it is a contact that gives us a lot of problem because they don't want to come into hospital. But we have to tell them, lot of health education went through, and I went with them also by boats, by sampan, by hapopon, bicycle boat, to talk to them. And you have to talk to them very, very kindly so that they will understand. Yeah. So at that time, ladies and gentlemen, I was, as I said, that I was on both sides, and Dr. Urajanode was very pleased that I did it. And then came a problem. The public health inspectors were in my charge, and the public health inspector said to the doctor, there's one family which didn't want to come to hospital. And the parents were cholera patients, definite. So we managed to bring them to hospital. But the one son, which is a contact in the house, refused to. And said, why? You go back and tell him why you want him to come. They were kept for only for 3 days. They have a rectal swab, and then if it is negative for 3 days, they go home. Yeah. And so why can't we do it at home? I said, there's not the much facilities. They have to carry here and there. It's not nice to do it in the house. But he was animal. He doesn't want to come. And I told her husband, you go to him and ask him why, tell him why, and then bring him. He did? No way. This boy was so stubborn. I said, why? Did you ask why? He said, yes. Then what? He has a kerbau in the field. And that's the only kerbau that the family has. And that kerbau is an asset for them to look after the very fields and so forth. So naturally, the boy said, if I go to the hospital, who will take care of the kerbau? And it probably will be stolen by people also, so you would have lost everything. I said, yeah. So this is where your common sense comes in, and your skill in personal relationship comes in, and how you approach them. Yeah? Easy. I said, what, doctor? Bring him in, bring the kerbau. I broke all hospital rooms. I said, that's the only thing to do. You have to have a win-win situation. You have to tell the patient that this is very important. Okay, if the kerbau is important to you, okay, we bring the kerbau. So in a lorry, in the truck, the kerbau came with the boy. The boy was in the house, in the ward, and the kerbau was outside in the grounds, and we can look at each other every morning, and we think. And for 3 days they were here. And I still remember when the 3 days were passed, I used to bring my book, negative, positive, of all the patients that were. I was very particular about that. And I think they were very pleased. So when you go to the ward, it's like going to give the results of an examination to students. He said, hands up. Saya amat, amat mana doktor? I said, nah, amat lagi dulu, lagi dua hari. Okay. So he would understand. And then comes this boy, 3 days already, he said, I'm not really late. Okay. Dengan kebaw, late. He was discharged with a kebaw. So, the only thing he didn't do is to ride back on the kebaw. He was so happy, and you also feel the satisfaction of helping this boy from his problem, yeah, of losing the buffalo, which is the only income that he could keep, and not losing it to somebody else. So this is the way that you have to do, ladies, gentlemen, and students, when you work with people who are very, very ignorant, illiterate. Yeah? For poverty, we approach all the kampung people. And you know, working there, we have, one is to correct your attitude towards a medicine, yeah? And that you still want to dedicate yourself to the service of mankind. And with that, you must know the skill of interpersonal relationship. And this interpersonal relationship can only come from you. Only you can learn it yourself. It is not very much, then you cannot find it in any books, but through your experience. And this experience is not for just after 1 day, 2 days, no. It is after a few months or even years, which I found myself. Yeah? And why is it important? Because you will be working with people in a new working environment. One is that you will be with your boss, your chief, senior doctors, with your colleagues, and with the nursing personnel. And that is very important because you are a new doctor, you come with a gung-ho, you know, with your stethoscopes, you will not knuckle you. Sometimes you may miss something, and it's the nurses that will help you. So be nice to them, respect them as much as possible, because then they will respect you as a young doctor and help you. I found that very, very important, because it just happened to me one or twice. Yeah. Then the other thing is your relationship with the patient, your customers. The patient, not only with the patient, but their relatives also. Now, I believe I was told that IJN, Institute Jantung Negara, has got an ongoing course on CFC. We'll call it a contact customer friendly courses. They teach all new recruits that come to IJN to work, were given this course, how to be friendly with patients as they come in. The objective is to make the patient happy and not threatened of the hospital they are coming in. Yeah? You have to greet them, eye to eye contact, you have to know the name, and you have to smile at them. And how often have we had the time to smile at patients? Yeah? Sometimes we are already tired, frustrated, and then a patient comes, and the patients with the relatives so aggressively wanting immediate attention, you have to smile. You still have to smile. You have to be in contact with them eye to eye and call their name. So that will be a personal contact between you and the patient. And then make them happy, and they will be happy to come into the hospital. They will not fear the nursing staff and the doctors. And when they go home, they will be the ones who will propagate, who will promote the hospital and your service. So that is very, very important. There are times when relatives are a nuisance. And sometimes doctors also, as patients, are nuisance. Right? They are stubborn, and they think they know best. But when I send my husband to hospital, I draw back. I don't interfere in the management of the treatment of my husband. But I have to be there because the staff, the hospital wants me to be there to become what? To become a guard. Jangan bagi masuk, visitors. So, okay. They think I'm the only one can deal with that. While they do the technical part, I do this guarding on my husband. in the wheelchair, I was fine. And then the third one, of course, I'll leave this to gentlemen, other government agencies which you will be connected with. Then you never know that you have to consult the JKR or some other pharmacies department, right? And you have to make sure that your relationship with them are good. Yeah? And to have this skill in having this friendship, you must choose certain ways of approach. It depends on who you are targeting, who are your audience. Yeah? Because if you talk with the professionals, of course you might, you can talk high level, the medical terms and so forth. But when you come to the lay public, especially the rural, your language, your approach must be very, very simple. And first thing is, you must respect them so that they respect you, so that they will listen to you. Yeah? And the thing that you have to be in your approach is working in the rural area is the leaders, the kampung leaders. Yeah? And that was where I was always telling myself that I'm blessed to be a woman. I'm a lay woman and a doctor. Because they will respect you if you're firm, if you're kind, and if you're approachable. So I presume I had those features, and they are very close to me. They become close to me with the one. But at the beginning, it was tough, especially for a woman, right? An expatriate, and I come from Selangor, it's the tongue, right? I consider myself an expatriate. I have to learn the dialect. I have to be able to know what you're doing for yourself. And there, I knew why they don't run the hospital. Not only because of fear. It's because of the low income, poverty. They don't know anything about the procedures. And the third is important, which you must know a little at least, the culture. The culture of people working, living in the kampung. They have special culture which you must respect, and so that you have good relationship with them. Okay? So when you go and approach them, they will size you up from the head to the foot. Especially a woman. Yeah? Don't go with your bling bling or awareness, special dresses or so forth. I've become a plain kampung woman, just like themselves. They want you to look like themselves, then they'll be happy. And when you talk to them, you must talk simply using very, very simple words which they can understand. And then they will say, sometimes I get frustrated, especially when I want to promote family planning. Here I'm sitting with them, with all the paraphernalia in front of me. That time they were no oral pills or IUDs and IUCDs, except for the old-fashioned creams and diaphragms and so forth, and condoms and so forth. I was sitting with them for half an hour talking, and say yes, 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 and this and this, and then I said, okay, I'm a young okay. Terima kasihlah doktor, saya balik dulu dan beritahu dengan suami saya. Okeylah, habis. Wasting my time half an hour. But they do want to practice family planning because they are the ones who suffer through all these pregnancies. You go to any antenatal clinic in Nepal and pick up a card and you see red, red, red. Red means they are dead, stillbirth, or miscarriages, or premature, whatever. And then comes a blue entry. That's the obstacle history. We want to get rid of that. So we were determined. Okay. So we had this campaign for family planning programs, for antenatal care, and also aggressive immunization program. We fought very hard. And being in health service, public health especially, we have to do a lot of talking. Because health education is important. You have to be skilled in health education and how to deliver it to people. Yeah? You can imagine, I follow my midwife through the rural areas, and then to see to supervise them, to see how she talks to the mother, the young mother, to how to bathe the baby and to take care of the baby and the umbilical cord, so forth. And the mother, the old lady, will be behind her. That's always the case. And when I went there, I sat with them, the old mother was there, and I noticed that the midwife does it very well, and she asked the mother, Pahamda, if you understand, if you don't, please ask me. And because that she understood. Okay. And then I turned to the old lady. I said, "To Pahamda, it's not for her to understand, but at least she's there, she can advise the mother what to do if she misses out anything." She said, "To Pahamda." She looked at me, quiet, top to bottom, she sized me up, and then she said, "Cantik sangu, doctor." I was wearing a bun, yes. And she was looking at my bun and not listening at all what you were talking about. And friends, then she looks at you. So be careful, dear students, that when you walk in a kampung, dress properly, dress nicely, so that they will like you. That's one. They put your clothes and your appearance top priority. I remember a young woman, a woman came to Pasu to talk, and she was talking for half an hour, and then sat down, the males on this side, the females on that side, and then question time. The ladies were all giggling, so I told the MC, which is the ladies, if you want to ask them what they want to ask a young woman. If they're too shy, then for her to tell this lady, and then we can forward it to the young woman. And then she went, and she came back giggling also, like those people. I said, "What happened? They want to ask why young woman didn't wear her earrings." And quickly young woman, you know, went up to her henchman to wear. She forgot to do it. She forgot to wear it. So these are the people they notice. They didn't notice what you wear, what you do, and how you talk. And if you do it right, oh, they'll fall in love with you. And that's very dangerous too. Now the traditional leaders that are in the kampung, you have to respect them. They are very important, they have a status in the kampung, and they're very influential. You must know the habits, the beliefs, the customs, and the culture of the people, as I mentioned. And these are the ones who perpetuated the culture and the habits. And not necessarily good habits. They are sometimes bad habits, not beneficial to the mothers at all. And who are the leaders? One is the Tok Mulu. Now, you know the states are broken up to the states, right? The districts are about the district officer, which is a government officer appointed by the government, and then he has his own units, and medical and the health department comes under them also for meetings, right? And then in the district there are mukims, and the mukims consist of many kampongs, so that's the division, yeah? State, district, mukims, kampong. And then the districts, the mukims, are headed by the pumulus. And formerly, pumulus are just elderly men, respected, but not much knowledge about what's happening, other than his mukim. And they can be quite respectful and sometimes very friendly. So during my time, there were few of them, and they were glad that I was there. I respected them, they respected me, and I'm very proud. Inside, because I'm a woman, they have different perception of women. So in their mind, I say, okay, so long as you're friendly with me, I'm okay. And then in the Mukims, they said the villages are Ketua Kampongs. And Ketua Kampongs are younger. And these are all liaison officers for us, government officers, to liaise with the people. They are good people. And then when the older pumulus retired, the government appointed young pumulus, kind, intelligent, educated, and active. Okay? And that became a problem to me. This young Polish, handsome looking. And then I have to Raja has already planned his 5-year program to put Umabi Dantini, Umabi Dantini, and this Pumulu will have to be in charge. So they come to me, the young Pumulu came up to me and said, Dr. Bukim Saya ni, need midwife clinic. She said, okay, give me the details to justify the need for a midwife to be in your clinic. Okay, okay. And it was justified. They have lots of mothers pregnant and children there, and which they have someone got to take care. I brought it to the land office, to the district office, where we have a monthly meeting, and it was approved. So while the building, the midwife clinic, quarter school clinic, were in the process of building, we trained our rural health midwives. And when it's ready, I get one which is very capable, posted to her. And we had a very nice majlis pembuka aning rumah bidan clinic. So all of them there, Bulu to Imam, and all these people will come, say prayers. And then I make my speech, and say to Bulu and others, to Tuan Tuan, tolonglah jaga bidan saya ni yang diminta oleh Tok Mulu untuk ibu-ibu di sini, kebaikan ibu sini. And then Tok Mulu later on will say thank you and so on. Okay, so that's my job done. Okay. And my nurses will go and visit this new life regularly as other procedures. And then after a year, we look at the report. I said, why is this midwife has no cases, no deliveries? And why is it only few mothers come to bring their children there to see her? Then the staff nurse came back to visit. The midwife is now married to the Pumulu. And I like it, so. That this is what you have to come. You have to face the challenge. Then the Jagu, I call Pumulu. I said, Pumulu, Tok Mulu, no more Tok Mulu. She's a young man, handsome man. I said, Pumulu, saya bagi ni untuk, saya bilang sebab saya untuk Pumulu jaga keselamatan dia. Okay? He took it very seriously. Okay lah, this is one of my challenges. And I warned him, you better be the PR for her and ask all the pregnant mothers to go to her for an infant checkup and take her to the delivery. And you know, ladies and gentlemen, you know, it's very difficult sometimes to know that once a girl from that kampung goes to learn midwifery and come back to the kampung, people will not take her for delivery. Why? Because makcik lah, mak lah, kakak lah. They don't want to deal with any of their reality. They are shy. So when this midwife becomes a Pumulu's wife, lagi they won't take her at all. They are scared. So they go to another or take the Tok Bidan Kampung. So I warned the Pumulu. I said, you better do your promotion for them to come and take your wife. Otherwise, I'll transfer her out of this mukim and put the whole Tok Bidan in her place. Okay, so that was some. And other sides of the story, sometimes when you feel sorry for your midwife because she's a frontline worker. Alone, if she's a bachelor girl, she's alone in that mukim. And around her, there may be a school or a police station which is helpful. We always pick that side for her so that she can always go to the police station or school for help. Because quite a number of midwives have been molested because they are alone in the album doing her work. So this is one that we have to be very careful about, which I'm very, very I told my health inspectors and staff nurses to always put her in her place so that she will not be unpopular in the mukim that she lives. Otherwise, this is very good. That's a Pumulu. But to come home, oh, they are very friendly, and they want me to go here and there to get health education. I said, okay, tapi macam mana nak pergi? Because there are no roads at that time. It's still the Bendang. You know, the Bendang roads is so small. Paddy fields on one side, paddy fields on both sides. And then when you go out in the drought season, especially after cholera epidemic, you have to go to people, go to the kampung to talk. You have to talk, and walk the talk. And he says, macam mana nak pergi, tak boleh masuk. Tak apa, doktor, saya datang nak teruskan. He's going to take me on his motorbike. Hati dah merempit, hati kan. So I told my friends, the heart is rempit, you are a bazoo for rempit. I've been rempiting. We want it to be good for us. So this ketua kampung comes with the motorcycle. And at that time, I don't use pants, I was wearing sarong. So how to sit on a motorcycle with this young ketua kampung? I couldn't put my hand on his shoulder because I was a little bit reluctant. So I was holding the motorcycle seat. And it was drought time. And you know when Kedah, when it's drought, it's terrible. You never see it now. The roads crack and the paddy fields are dry. So when the tire of the motorcycle went into the crack, you know what happened. We both were tumbling down into the paddy field. And I was so thankful that that time bus was quiet, Haraka was not in there. And there's no images for iPhone to get I with when we buy it. But then you have to go. You have to get they laughed, and then I had a lot. I still go to the couple, and they help out. And that's how they appreciate you, and that's how they like you. Yeah? So that's my contact with the Kutu couple. They are very good after that. Yeah? And then kind of beliers. The beliers, men and boys and girls, are very, very good. They come as volunteers. They are the ones who help you. Right? When you have kampung competition, or there's a baby competition, they will be the ones who come and help. And they're very active. They will do the work, and they will have volunteers. In any epidemic, we use them, and they're good. And the other one is the religious leaders. The religious leaders, I had one contact with them when we were doing our malaria eradication program, 1969, 19 to 70, that time. I was already in the as medical officer of health. I was then transferred, and of course we had to spray the DDT. And that DDT has got two kinds. One is the oily type, and one is the water type of DDT spray. And suddenly we were doing it very well. Of course the kampung, every house in the kampung will have to be sprayed, and they have to bring the furniture in the center for the sprayers to do on the walls. Of course they look ugly, yes, because the patches of the spray can go all in the walls. So it looked ugly. And then some religious leaders said, no, haram. And maybe it's the first time I heard the word haram in my service. And the first thing I did was to go to the late president of PAS, Yusuf apa ke nama ni, was staying near my house. I went to him and said, tolong saya ni. Kan orang kata DDT tu haram. Ada sikap memandu. You get the recipe of the DDT and we go together to the Jabatan Agama to sort it out. So we both went. I was waking up, okay lah. Tak tudung, then never mind, I go with him. And I explained to him, I said, look, which one is better? To save a community, men, women, and children of this dreadful disease, or to stop the DDT? Which one is more merciful? Which one would be blessed by Allah if we do this? So he looked at the list. He said, it's not haram. Okay, go ahead. I said, please give me the patwa. Put it in black and white, please. And okay. And we took it to the kampung. Then we started again. I said, you come to my house. You come to my house and see how they spray my house. No houses were accepted. And that was how we brought down, ladies and gentlemen, the malaria diseases. from police, we went down. There are four phases. And from police, we went to, we came to Mubassu, Kedah, and finally to Johor. And Kedah had this already consolidation phase, which means that the malaria was already almost eradicated. And if there are any malaria cases in the state, the PHI and the malaria team will go straight to the district of Mukim and control the mosquitoes there. And we didn't have any malaria cases there. If at all, it's one or two, and they're harmless. Yeah, but now, I feel very, very worried because we have migrant workers who comes from places where the health facilities are not so good, and they bring in the diseases. I believe now malaria is now getting more and more aggressive, and are not resistant to what we are giving them before. So that's my worry. So that's malaria, and that is body with our kampong, which is a religious place. Yeah. And but the rest, okay, when you go and talk to them, well, they, it's good to be with them, and Tun Razak, the greatest human prime minister that we ever had. I worked with him. I worked with him in the history, and he was the one who came up with the 5-year rural development plan. And what did he do? He cleared the poverty, ill health, and literacy and apathy by this program, 5 years. And he sees that everything is implemented from the state district level, Mukim Kampong. And we were happy to work in that scheme. He opened one of my clinics and cottages, and we were very happy. He really walked the talk. And then his network, what he did, first thing is to open up every rural area with his network of roads, providing them with water and electricity. For young Muhammad K. Johari was very pleased when we said electricity. He said, yes, give them electricity, then the crude birth rate will come down. We had a crude birth rate, that means the birth, you know, how fast our rate of delivery of mothers, it was 3.2. And when if we stick on to not giving electricity to the rural people, it will go, but there will be more births. He said, so keep them electricity so that they will concentrate on the radio or the television, and they won't give birth. So that's to reduce the population. Electricity. So we gave them, and we introduced the beginning, and as I said just now, they were very reluctant at the beginning, and especially when we introduced condoms, and that time the perception was, you want us to buy the condom or to take the condoms for our husband, it's like encouraging them to go to someone else, you see? So you have to be very careful and talk and talk half an hour and some by. I had to do that. So eventually they know the beneficial effect of family planning, and they want to practice it. So eventually they got into it. But once they got it, they didn't want to stop. I said, no. You have two children, three children. At first we said, you go for only two children. He said, oh, those are rumpus. I said, okay. You go for as many you want, children, your family, but space it out. Since you space it out. There was one time they even confronted me. The doctor to go mengandung itu? I said, yes. I want to have children, but I have spaced it out. So you do that also. You don't have to stop. You can have 8, 10 even, but space it out. Okay, then they did. And they were very, very happy. They become more lively, they take part in kampung activities, and the children are healthy. At the beginning, when you see them children running around with pot belly and brown hair, in the wards, the nurses have to count the number of worms that they passed out every day. Worms infestation, bacteria, polio, tetanus, whooping cough, everything. And you know, I'm so sad now that they are, that Pakistan was against the polio vaccine. They don't see, you know, they've never seen it, and you've never seen. I saw this one boy, he's a Eurasian boy, a teenager, in what they call an iron lung. It's like a coffin with a hole for the head, and then the box where the respirator was inside to keep her lungs breathing, to keep the lungs expanding and inhaling and expanding for the boy. And we feed him through one of the holes and clean the boy from one of the holes in that iron lung. Now we don't see any more iron lung. We should see if they are against anti-vaccine. So that's for the mothers and children. We had, and then, of course, after the couple and the traditional leaders, I told you, and the one real barrier for me, a real challenge for me, is the Tok Bidan. Tok Bidan are the traditional birth attendants, they will tell me. You'll never know. I think Sophia would know. When I was there working, there were about 1,000 of them. They are elderly women. They are not trained we have for our government one. They are trained from ancestry. Their mothers were midwives, so they carry on. And they are good people, but the thing that was against them, that we had against them, was the cleanliness. She will be in the kampung. She will be an ordinary woman, but respected elderly. She'll be doing the paddy field support, and while planting something, then somebody will shout, "Itu, mak saya nak salin. Okay, my mother wants you now." Okay, she drops everything, wash her hands in the water in the paddy field, and then go off. And then as she goes to the house, she sees one bamboo tree, cut one of the bamboo to cut the palika corn, and then she runs off to the mother and delivers the mother. So the mother is exposed to tetanus and infection of the postnatal, you know, because she is not clean. And then we had already a recognition that all Tok Bidans, we have to register at the health clinic and we examine their midwifery kits. When we see that they don't have any, we give them UNICEF, beautiful aluminium, just like our cosmetic bag, ladies. Yeah. Nice ones with complete with gauze, scissors, flavin to deal with deliveries of mothers. And she used to come to us every month for full inspection of this UNICEF kit to make sure that she has used it and clean it. Yeah, but they came with the UNICEF kit and we saw it was never used. And yet that was why it was clean forever clean, because she never used it. But instead she will be bringing sort of a tin box for cigarettes, flat or tobacco, you know, a pretty chocolate in a tin too. And then there will be scissors, rusty, and then little threads. And sometimes I see cockroach eggs and tobacco. And all the dirty things in that small box. And that is the new beauty kit. So you want to get rid of that, and to train and to educate this woman, not to have this her own midwifery kit, but we gave them a proper environment, UNICEF midwifery. But she didn't use it until there were so many mothers dying, mortality, and they were afraid to come. But now, why don't they come to hospital? It's because of poverty. The network of roads were not there then, and also they were ignorant, and because of this culture of getting permission from the elders, from the husband, from the old lady, and the whole kampung has agreed, bagula, bawa apa the patient into hospital. But the times is more ibarat. And from the house to the road itself, then when our road program started, the mother had to be carried in the sarong, like an animal, with poles, too many to be carried, and she's in the hammock. And sometimes she's bleeding all the way. But this is something which is preventable. And this is the only way to help these kampung folks to understand what our purpose is, to have the facilities and the service in the rural areas, is to help them live a longer life and to help them be healthy. So that's why Tun Razak's development program was wonderful. He was a great man, she. And then, when they come to the hospital, kenapa tak pergi, tak ada transport. After all the permission granted, the husband brought to the hospital. And at one time, I just couldn't stand it. The husband brought the wife 3 days after the placenta had been in and not delivered. The child was delivered, but the placenta got stuck. For 3 days, I don't know what the moment time was. When that thing happens, the tobidan will disappear. And the woman will want to do. I had to just put my hand right in. No time to have mask, no time to clean my hand, no time to do anything to prevent me. I just put my hand raw and take it up. But sadly, unfortunately, after that, the wife just passed away. When I passed away, I was so emotionally affected by it. I told Dr. Biswas, my obstetrician and gynecologist, he said, Hasmah, doctors don't cry. Don't cry. So I said, you go and wash your face and tell your husband what happened to your wife. I said, okay. So I went and told my chi, my doctor, said, Uncle, your wife is no more. The first thing he did was to raise up his head to, I think, ask for blessings from Allah for the wife to go to heaven. Just like that, I thought she would be mad at me or something, like cry something. He didn't, but he gracefully lifted her head. I turned around and went back to the room. I cried. It was so emotional for me. But these things can be prevented. The diseases, conditions that women suffer during pregnancy can be prevented. And now I'm very, very concerned because during the time also, we advocate hospital deliveries for first pregnancy and fourth pregnancy onwards because you want to ensure there's no red markings in the entity. And we did, ladies and gentlemen, we did. They listened to us. And 69%, 70%, 80%, 90% are going to go to hospital. So even the second, third also wanted to go to hospital. Because they have already confidence in us, and we treat them very well, and they got the results. So they were very, very happy. And then, what about the children? So we said, okay, and the Ministry of Health said, we must expand our rural program, the health program, by making the midwife clinics into a children disability community center where the midwife can be trained to look even after the children, after the toddlers. She can give immunization and everything. She can treat the child and the mother at the kampung level. So we did. While the program was expanding, we trained our midwife, Audrey government midwife, in our rural health training school in Chitra, where I was principal. We trained them to become community nurses, and we succeeded. And this was it. And another thing that we did, we brought in the traditional birth attendant, Tobidan, to attend a course and register them, give them courses about other things, about family planning, immunization, and so forth, and make them health promoters. And they were very happy. We said, to a doctor, we said, saya pun dah tua. Kalau saya tak boleh nampak lagi apa yang saya potong. I said, okay, it's time for you to become just health promoter and let the government wife do the delivery. And they agreed. And they were very, very cooperative. They were happy. And of course, they are the ones, the traditional leaders, are the ones who perpetuate the habits, customs, and beliefs. The culture is different. Right? But you know, beliefs means sometimes they attach it to Islamic colonial Islamic rules, which is nonsense. I said, okay, where in the Quran or in the Kitab it says that Muslim mothers must take only rice and chicken cream and that's all. That is not good for the mother because she's going to breastfeed the baby. Siapa beritahu? Depa. Depa was day. Who's the day? Day. You never find out who's the day. So we have to change. We have to change them. And therefore the traditional beliefs and customs, we have to look at them. Those which are humblest to the mothers, will say, don't follow this. Or give an alternate exercise, whatever, to replace the ones that they have been doing. For example, the humblest ones are the food tables after delivery. Okay? After delivery, the food for the mother is very, very restricted. No vegetable, nothing, rice, only a big full of plate, all carbohydrates, and barely a glass of water. And how would the milk be flowing? And ikan kering, what does ikan kering do? Gives you a good appetite, of course, huh? But other than that, it's not beneficial. So we want them to eat anything they like, and so that the baby will have all the nutrients from the mother. That's one. The second bad thing is when postnatally they put hot bricks on the tummy of the mother, or hot steel wrapped up in cloth, of course, on the abdomen of the mother to help the uterus to go back to its former size. But you didn't have to do that thing, because the uterus naturally will come back to its size. Okay, in a chapat kind of. That's no need. Sometimes you see the woman's abdomen black because it's so thin already, like a paper, because of the heat that was being pushed. And then they push, and that caused a lot of problem later on. Not at the moment, but later on when they have prolapse uterus. So these are the humblest customs, beliefs that we must get rid of. The good ones, breastfeeding, massage, the tuk bidan will be called to massage the body, which is good. But they carry on not only for 3 days. The bakila, sikit-sikit, get about 2 ringgit, and they will take 3 days for $3. I said, let her do it for 42 days, for the length of time that she sees the center, which is good, the massaging. And look good for the mother also, the well-being. And then they bandage to the abdomen and put hot water bags instead to give the mother adequate comfort. Breastfeeding is a must. They do breastfeed the babies. But we want them to continue until 2 years so that the baby will have good nutrition from the mother. So this is the reasons why we have to make a bit of culture with this gentleman and then provide the advice or the material for the Kampung Bidan to register with us and be with us throughout. I used to tell them to be done from the Amalaika to the Kaki, it belongs to the government. You take the region from the Amalaika to the head, that's your destination. And she will be there, you know, giving moral support to the mothers and so forth, which is good. They still want her, we still want her. Because sometimes in the middle of the night, the first person that they will call is the Kampung Bidan. And if the Kampung Bidan is trained as health promoter and listen to our advice to call the government invitator, she will do it. And because of that, I feel very, very respectful. I give a tribute to them because when we had the Safe Motherhood Initiative program to bring down the maternal mortality rates as far down as possible, I give credit to them. Because the channel for the Tokidan and the government midwife and all our staff nurses to refer the mother with complications to the doctor is wide open and it goes straight. And with that, ladies and gentlemen, our maternal mortality rate after the program came down miraculously. Formerly, it was 20 mothers 20 deaths out of every 1,000 lifebirths. 20. But when I left in 1974, like 2000, the maternal mortality rate was 20 or 40 per 100,000 lifebirths. So it is a miraculous drop. And I attribute this to our nurses, health personnel, and the midwives in the rural areas. I was asked, I had the privilege and honor to go to Washington to tell about our success story, and even for our infant mortality rate. Our infant mortality rate came down from 75 at independence down to 6 per 1,000 lifebirths by 2000. So I went there to tell our success story. We were fourth in the world for a decrease in infant mortality. First was Japan, second Great Britain, third was US, and Malaysia was fourth. We were very happy, we were very proud because of our achievement. And again, I went there to Washington to speak about the microcredit system. And I'm sure you know what that. Amana Ikhtiar, Malaysia, who gave a chance to the women in the kampung to do something to get that really successful, especially in the kampung. And we were proud of that too. So ladies and gentlemen, this is a quick session of my experience, but this is something which you must know. Yeah? We were succeeded, we were very aggressive, and why did we don't have any malaria, diphtheria, and so forth? Because of our aggressiveness and firmness in doing the program for the people. It's nothing for self-reward or anything, no. It is for the people. When we brought down the children killer diseases, polio was eradicated from this. And then we heard about one or two coming out. And the other one is the diphtheria. Diphtheria disappeared. They don't even know. Our young students didn't even know what was diphtheria. And tetanus. We told them that we go through the traditional birth attendant to be done. What tetanus means? Because you are dirty. Your hygienic, unhygienic conditions that you, when you were delivering a mother. And then the whooping cough. So we were aggressive in our immunization program and we eradicated all this. Formerly, during the British, they were concentrating on smallpox. Then smallpox was very scary, kind of, they would get on your face, with scars all over your face, everything. But then they went on aggressive smallpox vaccination. And they just scratch your arm for that bubble to come up, and then you had your immune. Yeah, so that was what we did. You must have vaccination to immunize your babies. Now, it's a thing which I'm very, very sad to inform, that there are anti-vaccination, anti-immunization campaigns against the government's program, and that many of them are in Kedah. But we had one bacteria epidemic, very small one, we managed to control it when I was there as a medical officer. We had controlled it very well. And after that, the mothers went for the immunization program for the children. And they didn't complain. But now, it's coming up again. And this is what I heard, that they are campaigning against. Mothers come to hospital with a letter. Not to do this, not to do this, not to do this, and this, I want the doctor to sign. I think it was the other way around. I was shocked. And then there's another move for mothers, but not to deliver in hospital. They want to deliver at home. And not attended by anyone, any trained personnel. And when you said, why you do that? You will lose your child if any complications. And during the delivery, how would you contact anyone to help you when you are delivering? If, for example, your placenta didn't come out, how would you contact another person? No, they want natural birth. And smart reply was, if the monkey can deliver the babies up on the trees, why not humans? I said, okay, it's all right, be a monkey, I'm not a monkey. This makes me unhappy, you know, because all of the efforts that we did for the goodness and life, happy life, long life for the mothers and children are not being denied. And I hope not. And you young students, please make sure that when you become a doctor, be proud to be a doctor. Dedicate yourself to these campaigns and make sure that they're not against it. Yeah? And then there comes this new concept of water birth, water babies. But some of them are good if the only person who attends with you is a doctor. Then I've heard our astronaut had two deliveries, water deliveries, and he was there himself and he helped his wife. Okay, it's fine because the husband is a doctor. And then get someone, makcik ke apa ke, cik ke apa ke, masuk dalam tub, banyak saliva. I can't imagine. So it feels that I'm denied of what I had done before. No, I hope not. With you young students, I'm very confident that you will continue to do what is good, and God will bless you. Don't think of monetary awards. I got my reward 40, 60 years ago. After 50, 60 years, after I retired, one lady came to work with my husband as a PA. And on the first day, he said, Tun said, my wife, my mother-in-law said, you delivered my husband. Okay, good. How is he? It's fine. Oh, thank God. He said, yes, I know, I remember I delivered your husband. And I told him, your wife will be one day working with us. Okay. And then another one, which is one more gratified, the one gentleman came up to me and said, Doctor, Atun said, thank you very much for saving my life. I said, well, were you drowning? I cannot swim. No, he said, my mother came from police. I was on duty in General Hospital, Arista. She came with a threatened abortion. And police sent the lady to us in Arista for management and for a DNC, because she was going to miscarriage. I examined her and said, no. She's not. Keep her in the ward for 1 week and we'll see what happens. 1 week she was okay, she went back and delivered this boy, this young man. How gratifying. That's the reward you want, not money. Money, of course, like doctor must be a doctor. Of course. But in what sense? What respect? Be thankful that you are a doctor. Serving the people with your heart and feelings, emotion, but not, don't be too emotional like me. And then you will get the reward later on. Yeah? Now, the modern days now, for you young students, you'll be facing a lot of more challenges than me. Okay? You have many of them. You have many of you in the faculty. Okay? Unlike my husband, we had only one woman to choose from. Okay? If we had been at this era, we would have chosen from many of you. Okay? And I always say, okay, you can choose from many, but not sure you can be a prime minister. Huh? Before I end, there are two concerns that I have. For you to give a thought, yeah, and to think about it. One is, as I said, the anti-vaccination campaign, and the other one is the home delivery with the attendants as well. But there are two other aspects of conditions, health conditions, which I'm a little bit concerned, and everybody's concerned also. One is special children and the disabled. They have been neglected for many years, and they need to be helped in as many ways as possible. They are sometimes very, very intelligent. I had a student in MMU before, when I was chancellor, I left being the chancellor, he had rheumatoid arthritis, he was disabled, but was brilliant. And he passes MMU year by year, semester by semester, President's School, President's School. And he graduated as IT with specialty in security. But unfortunately, they never taken aware of his ambition to a good security in the national computer security in computer, and he was just given the table with a computer in front of him. That's all. No direction what to do and so forth. He was so unhappy. He was frustrated because there's no job satisfying. That could satisfy him that time. So we moved him. He left. He left and he applied for IBM, Shell, and others. And he went together with other interviewers. And he knew that those people had lesser qualification than him, but they were taken anyway. And he was not. And why? Because he was on a wheelchair. So that was sad. So please think of this. Now he's happy because. DRP took him and gave him a nice place, gave him the facilities to go to the loo and to the lift comfortably, and he got a place of his own to do his work. He's very happy now, and that is something that you have to think. And the other one is mental health. The number of people who suffers from mental illness, mental disorders, are coming up because of the stress that we are all in for a little thing. And both the disabled and the mental health people have been very neglected, in fact, quite neglected. And the parents and the families have a fear of guilt, fear of shame, and denial because they have a family member which is in this condition, especially mental health. When you see a person with mental health, you don't say anything, he says, okay, but he is not in good health. So we have to pay attention to these conditions, and we should do more awareness campaigns about these conditions so that people can be aware and people can be, what we call, counseled, not to be ashamed, not to feel guilty about what a member of the family has suffered, because these conditions can be helped, and at least to prevent the person to become violent or worse and deprived of the parents and of so many things which they can do for other children. So it's quite timely now that Professor Andrew Mohan Raj has come up with a book, a collection of essays, which is simple for anyone to understand, and it's called Battling Diversity, and it's a simple, interesting essays for all of us to read, and the reasons why things happen, mental illness happens, and the disorders happen to certain people. So it is very timely that Professor Andrew has come up with this book, and you will soon have it launched this morning also. So with that, ladies and gentlemen, I think I've gone through my life story. I worked so much for Gopal Basu, and I pay tribute to all of them there. In fact, anyone in Gopal Basu, and Termasuk Raja Loon semua tu, know me well. And 1974, when they had the election, I thought they would nominate me to be a member of my brother. But instead, they selected my husband, and he won hands down. No, if it had been me, I would have been a member of the Sabha. Thank you very much.
distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. Please let us again thank Yang Amat Berbahagia Tun Dr. Siti Hasmah for a very personal and awe-inspiring history of public health in this country. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, the World Health Organization has defined health as a state of physical, mental, as mentioned earlier, and social well-being, and not merely the absence of disease or infirmity. A very old definition of public health by Winslow in 1923, as the science and art of preventing disease, prolonging life, promoting health and efficiency through organized community efforts, and the development of social machinery which will ensure every individual in the community a standard of living adequate for men, is still very much applicable today. And whom Dr. Siti Hasmah just elaborated on the whole social machinery of public health. The healthcare sector has grown in leaps and bounds. Curative medicine has always seemed to take the limelight. This is all the more so due to the push given by the pharmaceutical and the medical device industries. However, it cannot be denied that the major contribution to reducing morbidity and mortality in the world have been due to public health measures. These, including vaccination, which Dr. Siti Hasmah strongly believes in, and we all strongly believe in public health, motor vehicle safety, control of infectious diseases, examples, diphtheria, tetanus, the various mentioned earlier, behavioral change, and all the more so now in recent years, the recognition of tobacco use as a health hazard and its control. Both access and financial challenges in healthcare remain till today. Noting this, the United Nations Agenda for Sustainable Development, launched last year in 2015, and its Sustainable Development Goals, the SDGs, and the targets to be achieved by 2030 have emphasized the role of public health measures, and this is rightly so. As Perdana University goes about starting to conduct its postgraduate program in public health, it was felt appropriate that Perdana University launch a lecture series in public health. The leadership at Perdana University felt it was only fitting that this series be in the name of Tun Dr. Siti Hasmah, and I guess you all know why today. This country, she's very well known for her contribution to public health in the various areas of maternal health, mental health, drug abuse. A medical doctor by training, she has contributed tremendously to mental and child health. Examples you heard just now, family planning, again examples there, mental health and drug abuse. In fact, her efforts, including educating young people about the dangers of drug abuse, led her to being invited to attend the first ladies' conference on drug abuse in Washington, D.C. in 1985. About the series itself, the public health lecture series, the Tun Dr. Siti Hasmah public health lecture series, the objective of the Perdana University Dr. Siti Hasmah lecture series on public health is to communicate information and stimulate debate on public health issues facing this nation as well as the globe. Key thought and opinion leaders have made significant contribution, in this case, Dr. Siti Hasmah definitely fits the bill, to this field, will be invited to deliver these lectures in the future. Perdana University is fortunate that the first lecture in this series was delivered by Tun Dr. Siti Hasmah herself. Thank you very much. To honor this occasion, I would like to now invite Yang Amat Berbahagia Tun Dr. Siti Hasmah to launch the Perdana University lecture series in public health.
Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. In the name of the Almighty Allah, the Most Gracious and the Most Compassionate, I hereby launch the Tun Dr. Siti Hasmah lecture series on public health. Thank you.
Thank
Thank you, Dr. Hasmah, through Dr. Siti Hasmah for officiating the public lecture series, and thank you also to Prof. Rampal for the introduction on the lecture series. I would like to invite Yang Berbahagia, Dato' Muhammad Nazir bin Norman, the member of the Board of Governors of Perdana University, Yang Berbahagia, Associate Professor Dr. Andrew Mohanraj, the author of the book on battling adversity, Puan Che Maimuna Che Kadir, the Chief Librarian of Perdana University, and Mr. Solomon Raj Vasudayan, the President of the Student Representative Council of Perdana University, to come on stage to witness Yang Ahmad Berbahagia, Tun Dr. Siti Hasmah, to launch the book entitled Battling Adversity, a collection of essays on society and mental health, and later to receive a copy of the book from Yang Ahmad Berbahagia, Tun Dr. Siti Hasmah. Once again, thank you to Yang Ahmad Berbahagia, to Dr. Siti Hasmah, and the distinguished guests on the stage. As a show of appreciation from Perdana University, I'd like to invite Yang Berbahagia, Dato' Muhammad Nazir, to present a token of appreciation to Yang Ahmad Berbahagia, to Dr. Siti Hasmah. Yang Berbahagia Dr. Muhammad Nazir and Yang Ahmad Berbahagia to Dr. Siti Hasmah. Thank you. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, that marks the end of today's event. On behalf of Perdana University, we would like to express our sincere appreciation to Yang Amat Berbahagia Tun Dr. Siti Hasmah binti Muhammad Ali for gracing this event.